Hello and welcome to Just Have a Think. Right now we're in the midst of a green industrial revolution every bit as transformative and disruptive as the one the world experienced over a century ago. Only this time it's not oil and internal combustion engines, but renewable energy and electric vehicles that are causing the upheaval. So are electric vehicles really a viable alternative to internal combustion engines? Well, it's certainly a fast-growing sector of the market. The number of electric vehicles on the roads grew by 55% in 2017 to reach 3.1 million worldwide. In the UK alone, it's predicted that there'll be a million electric vehicles on the roads by 2022, which is only 4 years from now, and that 60% of all new car sales will be electric by 2030. By that time, according to the International Energy Agency, the number of electric vehicles around the world will have grown to 125 million. In the United States, sales of electric vehicles were up 40% to 125,000 in the first half of 2018, driven largely, but not entirely, by Tesla's new Model 3. And of course, China continues to lead the way in the global revolution in renewable energy. Don't get me wrong though, there's still a lot that China needs to do before it can be regarded as some sort of paragon of environmental virtue. That's an entire program all on its own. But it's fair to say that China's leader Xi Jinping, who himself is an engineer by profession, believes wholeheartedly in the benefits of a rapid transition to clean energy, and as a consequence, China's growth in every sector of the renewable energy market is quite remarkable. According to the International Energy Agency, 580,000 electric vehicles were sold in China in 2017, an increase of 73% over 2016 sales. And a similar increase is quite likely in 2018. Now, the biggest cost component of an electric car is its battery, and most batteries today use lithium-ion technology. But as with every other commodity, batteries are subject to economies of scale, and according to one company's CEO, Josh Prewer of FlexGen, the price of the batteries his company sources from China and Korea have come down by 20% just in the first 6 months of 2018, and the US tariffs placed on the batteries are not going to have a material impact on surging US demand. Tesla have gone one step further by announcing that they'll be building one of their gigafactories in Shanghai in China to make cars and batteries for direct sale into the Chinese market. So some obvious questions come up for average consumers like you and me if we're thinking about buying a new electric vehicle. What's my choice of make and model? What's the price range? How far can I go on a battery charge? And how many places are there to charge my battery up? As for choice, well, pretty much every car manufacturer has either already got an electric model in the range or is due to release one in the next few months. And there are now electric vehicles in every sector of the market, from the top-end luxury marques right down to basic entry-level vehicles. Now, if you haven't heard of Elon Musk, then you really need to get out more. He's the chief executive of Tesla and SpaceX, and whether you think he's brilliant or crazy, he is definitely a genius, and for what he's doing to disrupt the transport industry right now, he most certainly earns a place at the top end of our Muppet Genius board. Tesla are probably the best known brand and certainly the best selling EVs in the United States. Their Roadster, Model S and Model X SUV have proven to be popular choices in the luxury car market, all boasting scintillating performance that competes with the likes of Porsche and Ferrari. In fact, their Model S P100D is claimed to be the fastest production saloon in the world, with a 0-60 time of 2.5 seconds, although you will pay over $100,000 for the privilege of owning one. Jaguar have now jumped in with the release of their new I-Pace SUV. It's also towards the high end of the price range at £59,000, but it boasts an impressive 90 kilowatt hour battery with 396 brake horsepower, a 4.8 second 0-60 time, and a 298 mile range. In fact, a whole raft of SUVs are due to come onto the market in late 2018 and early 2019, with Audi, Mercedes and BMW all moving into this important sector of the market. At a more affordable level, Tesla's new Model 3 starts at $35,000 in the US and a likely UK price tag of around £31,000. For this price, you get a 50 kilowatt hour battery and a still very rapid 0-60 time of 5.6 seconds and a range of about 220 miles. Healthy competition for Tesla comes from the likes of the Chevrolet Bolt, the Hyundai Ioniq and the BMW i3, all available for under $40,000 before any federal tax credits. In the family car category, the Nissan Leaf is the most popular choice over here in the UK. The 2018 model starts at £22,000, including a £4,500 government rebate. This buys you a decent sized hatchback with a 40 kilowatt hour battery, providing 148 brake horsepower, a range of 217 miles, and a 0-60 time of 8.5 seconds. Volkswagen offers an all-electric Golf and an electric Mini called the E-Up. The Golf starts at £28,000 after subsidy and has a 35.8 kilowatt battery that gives 134 brake horsepower and takes the car from 0-60 in 9.6 seconds. VW claim a range of 186 miles for the Golf. The E-Up is geared more towards city dwellers with a price of about £21,000, for which you get 81 brake horsepower and a range of about 99 miles. Renault have the electric version of the Zoe starting at around £22,000, with the ZE40 model sporting a 40 kilowatt hour battery and 106 brake horsepower. Kia have the Soul at around £25,000, and Citroen offer the C0, a derivative of their C3 model, which starts at under £20,000 and gives a range of about 90 miles on a single charge of its 14.5 kilowatt hour battery. Now, I'm certainly no Jeremy Clarkson, so I'm not going to attempt to give you a full detailed review of any of these models. Google any of them though, and you'll be provided with all the information you could possibly ever need. So let's just take it as read that car markets all over the world will shortly be dominated by electric options at every price level. And given that fact, the more important question, at least in my view, is how well developed is the infrastructure to support my potential new investment? Well, let's take a look at the US and the UK to see how things are developing on either side of the pond. Once again, it's Tesla who lead the way in the States with their extensive and ever-growing network of superchargers. Here's the map of superchargers in America. The red pins show chargers that are open now, and the grey pins show chargers that are coming soon. These outlets can put 170 miles of range into a compatible battery in about 30 minutes, and plans are in place for even faster chargers that could potentially do the same job in around 15 minutes. As well as Tesla, Volkswagen's subsidiary company called Electrify America are starting to roll out a comprehensive network of chargers that all electric vehicles can use. They'll be investing $2 billion in the program, which will provide chargers at more than 650 community-based sites, mostly I think in Walmart car parks, and over 300 highway sites across the country by June 2019. The sites will be located no more than about 70 miles apart. According to an S&P report in July, US utilities across the country have announced numerous EV billing plans as well as expanded plans for battery charging facilities to prepare for the rising plug-in vehicle fleet. Among those utilities are Duke Energy, Dominion Energy, Florida Power and Light, Southern Company, and Public Service Enterprise Group. On June the 26th, Southern California Edison proposed to the California Public Utilities Commission a $760 million four-year program to expand from roughly 1,000 charging stations to 48,000. Over here in the UK, great credit has to go to Ecotricity for pioneering the rollout of an extensive charging network across the country. They now have fast chargers covering virtually the entire UK motorway network, with plans to extend coverage onto A roads and beyond by 2020. They've got a great interactive map that you can navigate around to find exactly what's available on any given route. Tesla's network is also pretty impressive here in the UK, as you can see from their map of charging sites. And BP have just bought ChargeMaster, which is the UK's largest charging company. They've already got 6,500 charging points in the UK, and BP plans to install new ultra-fast charging points at every one of their existing 1,200 petrol stations. And these will be 150 kilowatt rapid chargers that'll deliver 100 miles of range in 10 minutes. Shell also have big plans to roll out chargers at all of their UK forecourts, with the first one installed in the Holloway Road in London earlier this year. And you can click on this link to see Robert Llewellyn's report on that installation for his brilliant YouTube channel, Fully Charged. And there's also a website called ZapMap, which provides a map of the location of every single one of the more than 13,000 electric car charge points currently available across the country. So very soon, finding a fast charge point for your EV will be no different to finding a petrol station for your internal combustion engine car. Now, some sections of the media have published scare stories about how all these electric vehicles are going to use up all the electricity and cause power outages all over the country. In the UK, the National Grid estimates that even if all cars are electric by the middle of the century, then an extra 18 gigawatts of capacity will be needed on top of the current peak demand of 60 gigawatts. But plans for new renewable energy resources will more than accommodate this uplift in requirement. And with technology known as automatic time shift charging, electric vehicles can be plugged in at home at 6 o'clock, for example, but not actually start to charge until the low demand hours kick in after 11 p.m. In fact, power suppliers around the world now recognise that electric vehicles will actually be beneficial to the smart grids of the future. They effectively function as a mobile energy storage facility, which can be used to smooth the spikes in demand that occur at peak times like early morning, when millions of kettles are switched on. By charging EV batteries overnight during off-peak hours, smart grids will be able to draw back some of that stored energy in the morning, and you'll be able to control how much power gets taken from your vehicle via an app on your phone. And you won't worry about money, because once the initial grid infrastructure has been paid for, the actual supply of green electricity from renewable sources like wind and solar in a continent-wide distributed smart grid network will be close to zero cost. Chargers are even being installed at the bottom of lampposts in roads where there are apartment blocks or houses without drives and garages, and induction charging technology is being developed that could even mean charging pads being installed in each parking space. In fact, BMW already sells such a charging pad for their top-of-the-range electric 530e model, although it has to be installed inside a domestic garage just at the moment. But if this sort of technology gets adopted by the wider market, then in the not-too-distant future, we may well be able to simply park our electric cars over the top of one of these pads out in the street to initiate the charging process. No need to even plug in, no need to worry which parking space we're in either, because the electricity supply will be free anyway. So the momentum for electric vehicles and battery storage technology is growing extremely fast, and we're very close to the point where range anxiety should no longer be an issue, and charging your vehicle will be as convenient, if not even more so, than filling up a traditional internal combustion engine car with fuel today. In next week's programme, I'll be looking at the other major technological solution to electrifying our vehicles, hydrogen fuel cells. I'll also be assessing the ambitious claims of supercapacitor and solid-state battery manufacturers, and comparing the various pros and cons of each of them to the more established lithium-ion batteries that are used in most electric vehicles today. That's it for now though. Please do subscribe to the channel if you've enjoyed watching the programme, and don't forget to hit the notification bell to get news of whenever a new programme comes out, and you can do that by clicking the link that's appearing over here somewhere. In the meantime though, thank you very much for watching, have a great week, and remember to just have a think. See you next week.